What's going on, everybody? This is Mark Becker here on Civic Media with the Rational Revolution. And we've got a powerhouse of guests this week. Thank you once again for joining in. Today, sitting with me in studio, holy cow, in the friendly confines of the of downtown Green Bay, we have Amaad Rivera-Wagner. What's up, man?
Hey, how are you?
I'm great. So you're here for a couple different reasons.
I believe so.
Yes, yes. I'd love to learn about you, about your background and what you do. You're the chief of staff currently for Mayor Eric Genrich, wonderful guy. But then you also have you have a busy summer coming up.
I do.
Because you're running for the 90th Assembly District.
That's right.
Which is very cool. So I kind of want to start a little bit with, you know, who you are, and you know, like your background. You're from
Springfield, Massachusetts. That's right.
That is not a small area.
Well, it's about 150,000 people.
So the metro is like 700,000.
I know. That's because it's on the border of Connecticut. Oh. But the city itself is actually 150,000 people, okay. So it's a little bit bigger than Green Bay.
Yeah, you got some tall buildings.
We have a couple tall buildings.
Yes.
We have a river.
Yes.
We have a former manufacturing place.
There's trains. I know.
We have sports teams. It's the place where basketball was invented. We have famous authors.
Do the trains jam up traffic downtown?
they do not.
Okay.
Not at all. Oh. But we have other challenges.
Score one for Springfield.
Yeah, that might only be the only top score that they have. We can talk a little bit more about the hometown, but yeah.
Yeah, I'd love to know what that was like. I'm wearing my Red Sox hat. I feel like I'm an East Coaster at heart. Right. My aunt and cousin, they lived in New Hampshire, about an hour away from Boston. Yeah. And so
Nashua?
I was just looking it up because I was like, where the heck was it? They lived in Hollis, New Hampshire, little tiny town. Yeah. I've always been drawn there. My brother lives in D.C. And so East Coast is great. So talk about that.
Oh, what I want to first say that, you know, I'm not here representing my employer and that I'm here on my personal time to have all these conversations.
Okay, so perfect. That's a great disclaimer.
Right. And so thank you so much for having me. I'm very excited to be here. I'm excited both for what I've done for the chief of staff. I love the mayor. I think he's a talented, thoughtful person who cares deeply about this community. It's been an absolute pleasure to work for him, to help implement his vision for a Green Bay for All, and it's been one of the best jobs of my life to be able to serve in that capacity. How I got here is connected to my hometown. So
I'm
from Springfield, Massachusetts, home of Dr. Seuss.
I didn't know that. Oh, that's cool.
Home of Dr. Seuss.
Right on.
Home of the place where basketball was invented.
Yes.
Until recently, the home of Smith & Wesson, where many folks may know, which is like blocks away from my house.
How fun.
And so a really incredible, interesting community.
It's
the third largest city, or fourth, depending on the last census, in New England.
Really?
It's only 155,000. So it's more rural and urban. It has a combination of those efforts. It also has a lot of struggle, right? It's a community that struggles with inequality. It has some of the greatest racial inequality in the country. One of the largest income disparities between Latinos and their white counterparts in the country. And I often make the joke it's an incredible community. I'll talk a little bit more about it. But what I love about the politics I learned there is that we just can't blame Republicans for our problems.
Right.
But we have lots of problems.
Right.
And so we had to think more creatively and more thoughtfully, because the problem was power. The problem was the party. And so what does that look like when there are people who are interested deeply in progress and those who are not? And so I cut my teeth on getting into politics in a place where it wasn't whether you're Democrat or Republican, it was whether you were for progress or the status quo, and really passionate about making that difference. And so I was raised by a single mom. She had me at 16. She was kicked out of her house subsequently. And so we experienced homelessness, which often looks different for women and families. And so we often bounce from place to place. I lived in shelters for a time. Before I was in high school, I went to about seven or eight.
You do remember that?
Oh, very vividly.
Wow.
At one point, my mom was living in a car, and I was actually in the shelter itself. And so, but one of the most powerful things was that my mom worked so many jobs, even while she was homeless. And ultimately, with the help of our community, like places like Habitat for Humanity, we actually became homeowners.
Oh, wow.
And so, you know, for me, these stories and these moments are in government are about what we can do well and how can we create pathways and bridges from people for people who are struggling.
Right.
And not always, not a dead end, but how do we create an open door?
Is she still around? Is she?
Oh yeah. My mom still lives in, she still lives in the Habitat home that we got when I was growing up. She lives in Springfield still. She's desperate. She's come to visit and is absolutely enamored.
So when is she moving? No.
she's contemplating it.
Yeah.
And the way I got involved in politics, and then I'll talk about how I got here, was that I helped my mom organize a union. So I was one of the first people in my family to go to college. My mom was a PCA, so she's a personal care attendant. She takes care of folks who have disabilities, who are elderly, who might have mental health challenges, and she hadn't gotten a raise in years. And so my mom and I talked about what could it look like to make sure people take care of you and take care of the people who take care of their loved ones. And I said, well, I think a union could help. And we like sat together and then we reached out to SEIU, which I Googled and said, you know, I love my mom. We do everything together. I want to help her get the fair wages she deserves and better working conditions. A year later in meetings and votes and campaigns later, she actually won her union and was able to get a fair wage increase that she had been waiting for almost nearly a decade. And so that's actually how I got involved in politics. And then my community was, community activists actually sued the city because we had an all at large system, which was showing to be actually limits democracy.
Talk about that. What is that? What is the at large system?
So at large system essentially means that the whole city would be voting on the city council. And so what we found is that, and they went to court with this, that despite—
So there's no district lines.
No district lines. And what they found is that the majority of the council was elected from one-fifth of the city.
Weird.
Right. And the city, being almost 50% of color, had only ever elected one person of color to the city council.
So there's almost no representation.
Right. Despite this community being this diverse racially.
Right.
And geographically, almost all of the elected officials from there. And so they sued and they won. And then
What court was that in?
Massachusetts.
Was it the state?
Yeah, state court. Then also Massachusetts Supreme Court. They won. And then we created district seats.
That's cool.
Then I had just known some people from helping my mom form a union and actually ran for office on those new district lines and ultimately served as a city councilor. Served as a city councilor in my city. So I was very, very...
How old were you when that?
Oh, 20...
You're a very young city council person.
I was, and I look young now, but I'm not. I really like to say I'm old enough to know bad enough, young enough not to care.
It was right. Yeah.
But not 27 anymore.
Oh yeah.
So that's how I got into politics. But how I got here is I was working at the time for U.S. Senator Ed Markey as a policy advisor. I've been doing that for years, and I met this guy online who. Had a really crazy schedule. And so I was like, I'm never going to meet this guy. He's messaging me at 6 o'clock in the morning, 11 o'clock at night. I was like, what? This is crazy. We decided to meet up for drinks. He's 30 minutes late. not sure this is going to go anywhere. You know, very tall guy. And so we're having a great conversation. And I'm like, I'm probably never going to see this man again. So he asked me about sports. So we're having beer, talking about sports. And I said, you know, I'm in politics. So your assumption would be that I love the Boston Red Sox. I love the Patriots. I hate those teams. I've been in love with the Packers my entire life.
No kidding. Really?
And I said, I talked about Brett Favre. I talked about the community ownership.
Yeah, okay.
Right. And I said, this is a team that represents my values. I love how hard they work. Yeah. They are a team that to me at the time was like humble, but also was like homegrown and it wasn't this major city. I'm from the East Coast. That's how I felt. Right. And so had a lot of really strong.
Now you have some experiences with the Packers.
I'm not allowed to talk about that. So
no, that's fine.
Love the Packers. Go Pack go. And so I'm like, and he goes, I'm from Wisconsin.
Oh, was he really?
He's the son of dairy farmers. His family lives in Middleton. They're still on the farm. I go visit the calves every once in a while. And next thing you know, we go on a date every single day from that day. And 3 years later, he proposes to me.
No kidding. That's awesome.
And so we made a deal that and I can get into this too. I ended up running for office again. And the deal was, I'm going to run and I'll tell you why I wanted to run. I needed something that was really important to me. And I said, but if I lose, the truth is that we should be open to live wherever we want to live. And we made this whole list. We're kind of nerdy. So we had this whole list of the things that we wanted. And we were looking at DC, Baltimore, Philly, Tacoma, Colorado Springs, Boulder. And we were like, we could live anywhere. And a job offer came up here in Green Bay. The company was absolutely wonderful. Said that, invite your partner to come.
Oh, wow.
Didn't make assumptions. And, and when I found out it was Green Bay, I was like, I get to go visit Lambeau Field. So I was like, can I come?
Yeah.
And we got here and we fell in love. It's more racially diverse than people think. It is more dynamic. It has the best parts of the urban, the best parts of the rural. The housing affordability was off the chain. And so we got in the plane and we looked at each other and said, we have to rank them because we have a process.
All right. Yeah,
but I said, we're going to move to Green Bay, Wisconsin, aren't we? And he looked at me and said, I think you're right. within 3 months, we packed up, moved here, and we've been here for 5-6 years now, maybe 7.
So his connection was to Middleton, not
to Green Bay
whatsoever.
Right. And he loved Madison, Milwaukee. And so he had grown up and come to Green Bay and that, had no, he wasn't like, we should move to Green Bay.
Right.
It was a really great job offer. Let's check it out. We got to check out Lambeau Field. And this community has been just so good to us.
Yeah.
And we can get into the politics,
which is interesting.
But my neighbor makes me Christmas cookies every year before she knew my name.
Oh, really?
And she would bring them by.
Midwest.
And then the two neighbors down bakes my dog Valentine's Day dog biscuits. Our neighbors are just absolutely lovely. I have never been so embraced and supported. Cool. And it's just been an incredible experience to like live in this community. So very
thankful. Awesome. We're here with Amaad Rivera-Wagner, Mark Becker, your host here on The Rational Revolution. Come on back. We're going to talk a little bit about some city politics. Thanks. Well, this is quite the music selection here.
My mom would love this song.
Rational Revolution here is Mark Becker is your host. We're sitting here with the wonderful Amaad Rivera-Wagner. He's the chief of staff for Mayor Eric Genrich. He's the mayor of Green Bay.
I'm not the mayor of Green Bay.
No, he's chief of staff for the mayor of Green Bay. And then he's also running for the 90th. We're going to get deep and heavy into that in the next segment, but I want to talk a little bit about what you do now. So you came here on a job offer for your husband.
Right.
And we just talked off air a little bit. He's a physician.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that's got to be handy, though.
It does. And the kind of work he does is emergent situations. So it is nice to have someone who, like, if you choke, break your leg, get sick.
Right. I'm feeling a little funny. You don't have to make an appointment for that.
That's
generally
right.
Speaking, I would think. That's right. No, that's awesome. And so you came here for that, and you wound up in the mayor's office.
Yeah.
How the heck?
So, I've been in politics a long time. So I worked at the local level. I looked at the state level.
How was DC, by the way? So you were in the Senate. I'm sorry. Yeah. So you worked in DC. And this is near and dear to my heart because my brother lives and works in DC.
Fantastic place. So I was the policy advisor to U.S. Senator Ed Markey, who's the U.S. Senator from Massachusetts.
Okay.
So I helped him get elected.
That's awesome.
And then one of the jobs I had as this policy advisor was I was the go-between D.C. and the state.
Very cool.
Staff to make sure that we were having policies that were reflective of the actual needs of the state. So, you can get to D.C. and you could be talking about every major policy from telecommunications to appropriations to the approval of judges. And my job was to say, well, what does it look like to make sure that the policy makes a benefit and addresses issues that are actually in the cities, right, the towns, the rural areas? For example, we have a large population of Puerto Ricans outside of Puerto Rico, one of the largest. When Hurricane Maria hit, yeah, part of the job I did was help to coordinate effort with the federal government through the senator's office to make sure that they got the resources they needed as American citizens on the island. And so very, very proud of that work. Happy got him elected.
Yeah.
And so I got to spend a lot of time in Boston and D.C., and really, very, really lucky to do that for almost 7 years.
What a cool thing that experience could really,
right,
help what you do here. So I'm sorry, I interrupted. How did you get into that office with Mayor Genrich?
So I moved here and a bunch of my friends said, hey, there's this guy who's running
for
mayor, who's really, I think you'd like him. He is a guy who cares about policy. He cares deeply about the issues that you care about.
Yes.
He's running for office. And so we ultimately didn't connect until he was actually in the mayor's office.
Oh, wow.
So I sent him my resume and I said, hey, I just moved here. It probably seems like I seem a bit of an anomaly. I moved here because of my husband and I'd love to get to know you. And if there's a job opening, I love local government. Hmm. And I wrote in my email to him that that's where the rubber meets the road, that too often people want to talk about presidential politics,
yes,
congressional politics.
And I'm guilty of that. You know.
But then where everyday life meets policy is at the local level. And so if there's something there, I would love to do that. Within like a day, he emails me, let's come to my office.
How was the first conversation?
Probably, it was so fantastic. He's just a good guy.
Yes.
So he's like, same question you asked. How are you here? with your background.
How the hell did this happen?
Yeah, right. So the first 15 minutes of our conversation was to say, hey, I fell in love with the son of dairy farmers.
Yeah.
I was raised by a single mom. I care deeply about these issues. I want to work in government because I think that's where it makes a big difference. He's like, okay. So a job opened up in his office a little less a year into his administration.
Did you get a job on from that conversation immediately?
I was doing some work, doing some consulting work.
Oh, okay, cool.
Like across the country and all stuff like that.
Got it.
And then he's like, hey, this job opened up as a community liaison in his office.
Yes.
And I said, hey, I would love that. I'd love to have no commute. I live in uh-huh. Astor. It's like a 4-minute.
Yeah.
I was like, this would be great. The hours would be wonderful. Mm-hmm. There'll be no drama in the job.
Perfect.
And I was like, oh, like, yeah. I don't have to deal with the push and pull, uh-huh, of national politics. I can just be like a humble local public servant. So I took the job. And so there was a pandemic.
Really?
That hit within that summer.
You don't say.
The job.
Okay.
So I came. So that was right after the April election.
Yeah.
So I came in right after. So we're in the middle of a pandemic. I couldn't meet anybody. Most employees were remote, but I still had to activate all these different projects and elements and things for the mayor. And then we had the 2020 election. I had probably been there 4 or 5 months.
And, oh my God.
I was raised, so I told you I was raised by a single mom. She was very civically engaged, very involved. She helps run the police community relations organization in my community.
Yeah.
My mom's, so my first election I voted in was for, is a mayoral race, which is super nerdy because most people vote for president.
That's right, yeah.
And so my mom always got involved in elections. She's been a poll worker. She's
That's
worked
cool.
on campaigns.
She sounds like a badass.
She's like, I'm lucky. And so I was like, oh, I love helping out with elections. So I was like, oh, I should not only be a, I was at one point help with them. But when the mayor asked for like an all hands on deck for the 2020 election, I said, oh, I would love to help out.
Right.
You know, let me play.
I've done this before.
You know, I've helped out with elections before. So got to help out at the KI Center at Central Count. We don't have a version of that where I'm from. So I was like, oh, I'll work at Central Count. It's something I've never seen before.
Right.
And then, you know, I just helped organize volunteers, sign people in, order food. So I was like, oh, this would be
Make sure everyone's taken care of.
Yeah. And I thought it'd be an amazing experience.
How did that go?
So the irony, and again, hats off, that people forget that poll workers and clerks are the heroes of our democracy. And the truth is that they have done such a good job here and in Wisconsin, despite all of the vitriol and threats, that they continuously conduct great elections for people to choose the leaders that they deserve. And so very, very proud of that work.
Yes.
As many people may know, there was some contention in the 2020 election, albeit manufactured.
Completely manufactured, yes.
That people believe some things to be true. So
I forgot that you were in that room.
So despite being 5 months in and wide-eyed, mm-hmm. in love with Green Bay, Wisconsin, just wanting to help. I was ultimately accused of being a paid consultant operative that was flown in here who made up the story about having a husband to steal the election for Joe Biden. And the proceeding...
And live in Astor Park, bro.
Right. And that proceeded to actually for 2 years of actual harassment where they stalked myself and my husband.
Oh, my God.
His job. We had to actually get a security system. We actually had to put a safety plan together for my husband's job.
No kidding.
Because, you know, folks didn't want to take the truth.
Isn't
as the truth.
Wild?
And it was so interesting because that just isn't our experience with Green Bay residents.
Right.
They have been gems to work with. People don't ask That's me cool. who I vote for president before they help me, support me, engage with me. But for some reason, the idea that I had been a Democrat somehow terrified both these outside people who then proceeded to stalk me and my husband.
Well, and you know, not to get too into the weeds on council stuff because, you know, sitting here with Amaad Rivera-Wagner, he's the chief of staff for... the mayor. There are people that are and were.
Yep.
As they were. Some of them were defeated on the council that buy into some of this stuff, hook, line, and sinker.
Yeah. There's actually a council member still serving who organized a January 6th rally outside of Green Bay that actually called for the Proud Boys to come after myself, the mayor, and Celestine to get us.
Yeah.
I was. Love being a public servant, but you know this is a new era where that was possible, and you can still get elected even
the post-truth type thing.
Right?
You know, it's really wild here. But we are here on the Rational Revolution talking with Amaad Rivera-Wagner. I am Mark Becker, and we're going to talk about something he's got coming up this summer. We'll see you back in a little bit. Yo, we're back here with new friend Amaad Rivera-Wagner, and we here on the Rational Revolution, we're going to talk about something that you're going to be doing. And I have to say, how I found out about this was the strangest story I think that I've right. So the company, my company, we sponsor the Green Bay Blizzard, and I love the Green Bay Blizzard. Yeah. And so after one of the games, this was a couple weeks ago, you can take your kids on the field and all that kind of stuff. And so the we were out on the field was packed with people, and it was like 30 seconds long, the most strange, weird thing. Like the crowd parted. I couldn't find my wife. I'm looking for my kid. And this random person taps me on the shoulder and says, "You need to know this. Amaad Rivera is running for the 90th. And I'm like, I'm not kidding. This is exactly what happened. I have no idea who this person was. And I'm like, awesome. Like, he'll be great. Where's my kids? Like, what is happening? And like, and I turn around. I'm like, oh, okay. And then the crowd goes back and I find my wife, find my kids. Where the hell's this guy? We're like, what just happened? So I found out that Amaad Rivera is going to be running for the 90th. And your announcement said, I'm thrilled to announce I'll be running for the Wisconsin State Assembly to represent Green Bay, the city that I love. The community has given a person like me, who grew up with so little, so much. From purchasing my first home with my incredible husband to an amazing career that helps improve people's lives. Fantastic amenities like Bay Beach Wildlife Sanctuary. To neighbors who truly care about one another, especially in our toughest times. It would be an honor of a lifetime to serve the residents of Green Bay in the state legislature. You're running to steer us away from the chaos and conspiracy theories that have seeped down from the state house and bring a clear focus to what truly matters, building a brighter future for our families, small businesses, and our neighbors. I do also want to point out that Christina Shelton, the outgoing representative, and our dear friend, Mayor Eric Genrich, have also proudly endorsed your campaign.
Yeah.
Holy crap.
I know.
Oh my God. So so you're doing this thing.
Yeah. Well, you know, one, I really enjoy public service.
Yes.
I mean, what I get to do as the mayor's chief of staff is I get to do incredible things.
And you're good at it. I mean, you are.
Thank you. That's kind of you to say. You know, one of my dreams is that we're helping to build a neighborhood with JBS, and we are leading one of the most inclusive community-led projects, but we're also doing it fast. we're delivering for people. We're already at housing. We're going to have a destination park. We're going to have a urban farm. We're also going to have a relatively inclusive a boulevard, and we're going to have housing for all income levels. And we've been able to do that because we have a mayor that has a vision, but I'm allowed to implement these visions. And I'm very good and proud of doing that. And I love that we're doing it faster than we've ever done, more inclusive than we've ever done it. And we're going to have a real product for people by next year, and people will be able to live there potentially in 2027, 2028. And so I think there's something to be said about when you love something, you invest in it, you stand up for it, and you give it everything you can. And so with Christina leaving, with this new fairer maps that we've had, for the first time potentially in decades, there is a real concerted effort that the state legislature can do more.
Mm-hmm.
And as someone who's been at the local level watching, where we often have to go either around, behind, or ignore the state legislature as we suffer from environmental concerns, job access, workforce, housing access. Instead, we don't get that. We basically either go to the governor or we work it out ourselves, because we, at one point until this year, last year, we didn't even have appropriate funding for our local municipalities. And with the threat of fair maps was the only thing that moved it, even an inkling towards our direction. And so I decided to run because I think it matters that we have people who stand up for the city of Green Bay, who stand with the city of Green Bay, and focus on things that truly matter. I think we're all tired of the chaos and conspiracy theories. We're watching it play out at the local level right now, where someone's refusing to concede an election because they made up that fraud existed. And we're not getting to the work of the business. The council only has 11 members, and we are disenfranchising a whole district because we have somebody who just doesn't want to take the fact that they lost real. We need more people at every level of government who say, look, we want to get things done. There are real things here, like passenger rail. There are things like dealing with flooding. There's things like actually making sure that we have the infrastructure we need, that our bridges don't fall apart.
Mm-hmm.
These are bread and butter issues that you don't have to ask if you're a Democrat, Republican, to access great parks and good bridges. But we instead have people wanting to ban books and tell people who you should love and not love. And I want to run to make sure that we actually start focusing on policy, that Green Bay has done so much with so little. We've become the number one place to live in the country with almost no support from the state legislature. Imagine what we could do if we had the support, the funding, the legal tools that are disposable to tackle things like the mental health crisis, opiate addiction. Imagine what this community could look like with a little bit more help and a little bit more support. And that's where I'm running to make sure that happens.
I'm so excited about the new maps, you know, and as we talk with Amaad Rivera-Wagner, we spoke with Lee Snodgrass a few weeks ago. She's wonderful. And we talked about the disparity of, you know, if you are a Democrat in the assembly, and you want to get something done, you can't.
Right.
And you can only get it done if you do all of the work for a bill. Like, she got one passed.
Mm-hmm.
And you hand it to a Republican to get their blessing, and they'll do it for you. And, you know, and like some of those things, the disparity between Democrats, Democratic representatives having one staff member and having to share offices versus a new Republican having two and having their own. So, like, you know, it's just some of these things. And, you know, 5 years ago, I think it was, we're in open session. Robin Voss told then leader Gordon Hintz, you don't matter. You're irrelevant, you know, and so having these maps, because when I was, I've said this a couple of times, but when I was the chairman of the Republican Party, our representative to the 88th was, it was not Mako, but it was John Klinke.
Yeah.
We would talk about what was going on and all that. And so as these maps are being drawn, we were having a beer in his garage, and he said, you know, there's not going to be a Democratic majority in a decade.
Mm.
And, you know, as when I was a 24-year-old chairman, I was like, this is cool. And then all of a sudden you like take a step back and, man, that's messed up. That's not okay.
Right.
And so I am so excited for my kids, my family, and the true representation of Wisconsin. We can have a government that has, like, we can have representation in this state. You know, and so what does that look like?
Well, to me, fair maps really boils down to this. We want folks to be able to elect representatives that actually care about what they want and what they need.
Right.
And one of the things we saw here in Green Bay was that we had four or five state reps who had all little pieces of them.
Nice.
Some of, and maybe it was three or four. And oftentimes we saw them suing the city, Yeah. Or getting more, like when we saw the funding packages, we were seeing our suburbs, which are the majority of their districts, getting 200-400% increases in their funding, and the city was capped at 20%.
Weird.
Right. And so the thing is that we shouldn't be, there are Democrats and Republicans that live in Green Bay, Wisconsin. Yeah. The goal should be that people should be able to thrive. And I think what I'm really excited about is that fair maps make everyone have to compete. Yeah. I am running as a Democrat. I'm proud to run as a Democrat. I'm proud to have been a Democrat most of my life. But what I'm really running to do is get things done for Green Bay.
Mm-hmm.
And I think these maps are the first time in a long time where that is possible. And that's why I want to run.
Yeah.
And it doesn't mean that I always tell people that both at the local job I have and the job my husband has, we never ask people who they vote for president before we help them. When I'm at my dinner table with my very Wisconsin family, we do not agree on a lot of things. But one of the things we do agree on is taking care of one another. And that's one of the beautiful spirits about Green Bay. And we need more of that in the legislature. This petty infighting, this kind of cruelty, just for what? When I think that the truth is, like, opiates are affecting anyone, regardless.
What does it matter if whose name is on that bill if it helps people?
Right. And so I'm interested in doing that, but I'm happy. I'm running as a Democratic nominee. I'm proud of that.
Right.
I do think that one of the positive consequences of fair maps is that we need to have better Republicans running.
Yes.
We need, and it would be really nice to be having a marketplace of ideas and really being thinking about how can we look at things from different angles, from different constituencies. That to me is where the sausage gets made for policymaking. And it feels like we've missed that. When a legislature can hire someone like Michael Gableman and kind of just like make a mockery of our elections instead of saying, how about we fund our elections?
Yeah.
And I just want to like right the ship. I really just want to run to make sure that the Green Bay values and the issues that we need get represented in the legislature and that I'm an amplifier of those needs. And I'm really excited to do that.
Yeah, it's so funny. Again, with the conversation with Lee Snodgrass, we talked about the same thing. But it was like, you know, a consequence of these maps is you do not get the best and the brightest on the other side.
Right.
And, you know, and then coincidentally, there are people who could run for these seats that say, well, if it's a +7 Republican, why would I do that?
Right.
Why would I put myself through that?
Right.
You know, and it's such an exciting thing. Representative government is cool.
Right. Maybe that will be the criticism I get when I run. I am pro government. I do think government can play a positive role in people's lives.
Yes.
I've seen it play a positive role in my life. You know, the Habitat home that my mom lives in was a parcel of land that was donated to Habitat from the city. The Pell Grants I used to go through college despite getting scholarships are a federal program. The unionization rules that created the possibility for my mom to get better wages is something that got done through law and legislation. So like to me, I think government can be a force for good.
Yeah.
And I'm running to make sure that force for good actually reflects the needs of Green Bay. And I think that is so exciting to make sure that every community gets that support. And so it's not, for me, supporting democracy, supporting these fair maps is about every resident, both of Green Bay, but every resident of Wisconsin, being able to have people who actually want to cater to their needs, not to the people who they think are going to help them win elections.
Yeah, it was interesting. When I was first elected to the county board, you know, I was elected, I had help from the Republican Party.
Yeah.
And so, you know, you go in on like, less government, less taxation, blah, blah, blah. Well, my first meeting that I took was with the Brown County Library.
Oh, yeah, right.
And then my next meeting was with the jail.
Right.
And I met with people from ADRC.
Yeah.
And like all of those meetings, and I, you know, you get in the fields, you truly see the weight of need in the community. And it's like, oh my God, if there is not something and in government to help some of these people, they won't get it.
Right. And the thing is that some of these things are actual structural solutions, right?
Yes.
Like the Green Bay has not enough housing for every, we do not produce enough housing for every income level in the city.
Right.
Which means that there has to be either funding or new laws or making it easier to build housing at every level.
Yes.
We haven't tackled that, right? We want to make sure that we have fully funded public schools. We have a great 4K program. There's amazing ways in which we have preschool access here, but we don't, we need our schools to be able to meet the needs of an incredibly diverse growing population
yes.
in the city. We need childcare options, right? Like every family is desperate for affordable childcare options.
Yeah.
And we aren't trying to tackle that. And so, and to me, that's really why I was motivated to run. It was like, what would it look like if we try to tackle these things in partnership?
And it's frustrating to see, you know, like, and some of the people, I mean, even on the council, I've seen comments from alders. Well, you know, make child care affordable. Well, that was your choice to have that, you know. And it's like the ignorance and the pompous air that who are we to help you with your, like, it's just...
And I think that this is what I love about Green Bay, which is, again, like, I know I sound like a early in love person, so, but it's like, we think about really smart investments that people may not think about, but like Bay Beach is a government-run, locally tax-funded operation that creates generational support and it actually goes in the black every year.
Yeah, yeah.
So there are ways, you know, we have a wildlife sanctuary in the middle of an urban city that actually provides a school that is environmentally focused for our youngest residents. We are doing brilliant, smart things that are government run, government supported, taxpayer enabled, that are absolutely benefiting generations of residents.
Oh my God.
And we need more of that, not less.
Yeah. Oh yeah. And you talk about how it enriches the lives of the citizens. It's really an awesome, awesome thing. We went to the wildlife sanctuary, I think it was last weekend. And we couldn't get in. It was too packed.
It was packed.
Oh my God! There were people everywhere, and we wanted to go, and we couldn't. But that's a good thing,
right?
Because people are utilizing the stuff that's there, and Green Bay has so much,
right?
And it really is a neat thing. So it sounds like we're running up against a break here, but we're gonna keep this conversation going with Amaad Rivera-Wagner, and we're gonna talk about the 90th adventure. On the other side of the break. So we'll see you in a little bit here on the Rational Revolution.
Busted flat in Baton Rouge.
Another good song. Here we are on the Rational Revolution. We play good music here on Civic Media. You can download the app and listen to all these shows as many times as you want. Go ahead and do that wherever you get your apps. Again, this is the Rational Revolution. I'm Mark Becker. We are here with my dude, Mr. Rivera-Wagner, and you are going to be running for the 90th. And we were talking about that. That is so cool. It's exciting. It's a big deal. How did redistricting change the 90th?
So, I mean, folks who've been here longer than me, I mean, you might be able to speak to this. At one point in time, there was like an East and West.
Yeah, there was. It was like Howard.
Right, exactly. And so that was 20 years ago, approximately. The East, the 90th was always mostly Green Bay.
Yes.
So what slightly changed is it's now closer to that 20-year-old option, which is it's all of the East Side and only the Green Bay and a sliver along the Bay of the West Side. And so we are, the 90th is all of Green Bay.
Nice.
The 90th is only Green Bay.
Which is great.
And a little bit of the west side of Green Bay, which is fantastic that we're going to actually have.
That makes a lot of sense.
Which makes sense. But what it also means is that Green Bay is part of a larger conversation about two other districts, the 88th and the 89th, both of which are adjacent or include portions of Green Bay. And as you know, given these new maps, the majority is at stake, whether it'll be a majority Republican, a majority Democrat, it's at stake. And what people often forget, everyone loves Madison, Milwaukee. I get it, right? Like, they love that. I love Green Bay. But part of what people don't get is that the heart of every statewide election, every presidential election, are local elections. Green Bay is the key to winning and unlocking that victory.
When I was chairman, we had a keen understanding of that. And I always said, how goes Northeast Wisconsin, so goes the state.
Absolutely.
And so, you know, like big picture, like, you know, politics is all politics are local, but you're on a team.
Right. Right.
And so I think that so much of what you're going to be doing this summer is running your race too, but it's really going to be one that people watch very significantly.
Yeah.
For the big guy at the top.
Right. Whoever
our,
that is.
our senator.
That right. Absolutely.
I mean, you know, and it, I would really like to keep who we've got in there. And so, I mean, this is a big deal.
Right. I mean, what I want people to know is I think it matters. Yes, it's a team sport, but it's also about connecting people on their values.
Yes.
And I think we're talking about a moment now where what I do think I'm very good at, and I'm proud of this gift my mom taught me well, is that like you work with like-minded people.
Yeah.
And you work on the issues that matter. And I do think that we have a moment now here in Green Bay and our adjacent communities to be talking about the issues that we need that actually resonate with voters. And I think that that might lead to the majority. And I'm very proud of the idea that I want to work with, support, and engage people who, one, are passionate about Green Bay. We've got to get this whole idea that you can just bash our city over and over again, that everything is wrong with Green Bay, that we're not good, that we're, it's, I'm like, I'm just tired of the naysayers. Like, this is an incredible community.
It is.
And so that's my first litmus test. If you think that Green Bay sucks, we're going to have some challenges.
We're going to have some problems here.
So that's my litmus test. But I do think there is a lot of people who see the moment that we're in, where yes, the majority is at stake, but it's really about the values that we want to implement.
Yeah.
Strengthening democracy, making essential services more accessible, making sure everyday people have the resources they need from schools to childcare, but even things like mental health. You know, the reason I want to talk about this is my brother-in-law struggles with mental health issues and addiction. We tried to get help here in Brown County, and it was hard. Part of it was that we don't have the legal requirements to require people to get help when they need it if they can't ask for it. But two, we didn't have the capacity. Right. And one of the issues is funding and the laws that need to shift. And we overly rely on the public safety department to take care of that. The legislature needs to act, right? And if without that, and I think there's a lot of alignment on that. So I want to make sure that I help coordinate and support people who are running in Green Bay or adjacent to be crystal clear that I'm tired of the banning of books and culture wars. I'm tired of like, you love the right person at the right moment. I want us to talk about things like roads and mental health and funding for cities and municipalities and housing. Right. And I think that is what I'm very good at, is making sure those like-minded people work together and work to benefit us.
Yeah, because I think that's really how to connect and how to, you know, we talk rational revolution. That's how we can work with people who maybe an R and a D can work together.
Right.
Because it's working together on, hey, you know what? Cops shouldn't be shrinks.
Right.
And if someone, right. And if someone needs help, and another shock, a lot of people do.
Right.
We shouldn't be relying on people that are completely unequipped.
Right.
To handle that, because then we're going to have some problems.
Right.
And we're going to have people that have outcomes that they don't deserve.
Exactly right. And you see this all the time. I mean, we had issues where we had a shooting at the casino, right? Where someone could have been held more accountable or got more help or got more supports or had more boundaries placed on them. And they didn't. And we saw the consequences of that. And I think that people deeply care about these issues. And what's gotten in the way of progress has been politics, right? That as you were saying earlier, which I thought was so kind of telling, is that like it matters who introduced it, not that it was actually worth merit.
Right.
Right. And I go, can we move past it? And I'm not saying I'm very proud Democrat. I already know who I'm voting for president. I'm excited about supporting that person for president. I think Joe Biden's doing a great job. But I also think that like we have to start leading with our values and people, and not leading with what party you think I am.
Right.
And I really want us to make sure that those things are tackled. Now, there's some things we're just not going to agree on, right? Like I have some great friends, people in my family who we vote very differently. We disagree on some very deep issues. And so I'm, you know, they're where they're at and I'm where I'm at, but it doesn't mean that we have to be to the point where we're threatening people or making them not run or making it uncomfortable to exist. But we can enjoy one another, work on the places that we can. And I'm very proud to do that. And I'm happy to be supporting Democrats up and down the ballot who are quality candidates who are going to actually serve the people of this community. And frankly, if Republicans put up good candidates, it's going to be competitive.
Yeah.
And they should think thoughtfully about doing that. But I'm going to be supporting the Democrats who I think my values align with. And I'm very proud of that.
And I think what's neat about the districts is that we can put up, you know, people on both sides that are not polarized by politics.
Right.
And are really focused on just doing good things.
Right.
And that would be wonderful. Amaad Rivera-Wagner, how do people get in contact with you if they want to help you, if they want to donate? How would we do that?
So you can always go to my website, www.amaad4rgb.com, where you can make a donation, learn more about me, see pictures of my incredible husband, my adorable golden doodle.
You have dogs, yes.
Right? Appa and Lambo.
Oh,
we
nice.
Call him Bo for short.
Good.
He's trouble. Bo is the younger one. He's very good. Go Pack Go, but he's trouble. And you can learn more there, donate there. Obviously, there could be a primary that would happen in August. And then there we have that November election, which I hope to get through the primary and then obviously win in November.
I'd love to touch base with you sometime in the summer as well and see how things are going. This is wonderful. Thank you so much for your time. Mark Becker with Amaad Rivera-Wagner here on The Rational Revolution. Thank you very much.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, you got it.